Bulletproof Radio, a state of high performance.
Hey, it's Dave Asprey with Bulletproof Radio. If you haven't had a chance to check out the Bulletproof Career section, please do me a favor, head on over to bulletproofexec.com/careers and check it out, because we have an internship program. And if you'd like to work with a bunch of people who do things every day to make themselves and millions of other people better, this is the place for you. bulletproofexec.com/careers. Today's cool fact of the day is that if you think chameleons change their colors to blend into the background, you actually have it wrong. They're more like a mood ring, sort of compared to camouflage. They change colors to communicate with their friends, the other chameleons, and to show how stressed or what their emotions are. And it turns out actors are kind of like that, which is something we're going to talk about today. But before we get into that, you may not know this about me, but I once had an iguana, and he was 8 inches long, and he grew to be 4.5 feet long, and he would sit on my shoulder like a parrot. And he was the same way, and he would absolutely change color. He'd turn this deathly gray color when he was stressed, and when he liked me, he'd sit in front of me and like kiss me on the nose. His name was Skippy, which is the least appropriate name for an iguana ever, but now you know a cool fact that no one else knew. Today's guest is an award-winning writer, director, producer, a creativity expert, an inspirational speaker, and the artistic director of Anthony Meindl's Actor Workshop, which has studios in LA, New York, London, Vancouver, Sydney. This guy is Shailene Woodley's coach. He's been a guest teacher at David Lynch's Masters in Film program. He's been a panelist at all sorts of transformational leadership things. And just an incredibly interesting guy, not just because he works with actors, but because what he talks about is hacking fear. In fact, almost everything he does is about hacking fear and emotions and worry. And he's, you know, top people who've won the Golden Globe and things like that. So his name is Anthony Meindl. And Anthony, welcome to the show, man. I'm really pleased to have you on today.
Oh, thanks for having me. That was like a really nice, warm intro. If you pushed a button, there would be like fake applause. You know what I mean?
So when you get feedback like that from an acting coach, like that means something. So yeah. I'll take that. Yeah. Thank you.
No, you have a very presentery voice. Did you ever do voiceover?
I've only done voiceover in my first documentary about toxic mold called Moldy. And I learned a lot from Eric Troyer, the guy who does vocals and sound for Electric Light Orchestra, was our sound guy. So he was like, Dave, your voice sounds like crap. You have to fix it. So he maybe beat some sense into me.
Well, he did a good job.
Oh, thank you.
That was like awkward moment.
No, I'm like, where do I start now? Because there's so many things I want to ask you.
Okay.
And that's all right. We can always edit out anything that I say that I don't like, so people think I'm, you know, better than I actually am.
Yeah. Okay.
So what I wanted to ask you about, though, is you've had this chance to teach some of Hollywood's brightest rising talent. And that has got to be an incredibly hard thing to do. And I want to know, how the heck do you get into the business of coaching people who are like seriously kicking ass at that level? Because it's not an easy thing to do, especially for actors, because it's such a strange skill set. I find it foreign to me.
Yeah. You mean like being an actor, you mean?
Well, yeah. Like not only are you coaching like top performers, you're coaching top performers in acting, which itself is a very unusual skill set. So
right.
it's like you picked the higher tier of performance, and then you picked an unusual subset of skills, which is basically to show people an emotion that you may or may not be actually feeling,
yeah,
and to do it in front of millions of people. Like it's high stress, but it's also different than what a CEO or a pro athlete does. And so like, why that niche, and how did you possibly get into doing that? Because it seems like there aren't many people who do what you do.
Well, that's interesting, because actually something just stuck out, like, you know, when you were talking about a CEO or, you know, a professional athlete. I guess what I'm kind of known for is getting people to understand that acting, to me, the art of like being an actor or being a storyteller, which we all are, is analogous to just being alive. And so my approach to it is really like it's all about presence. It's all about the moment. And it's all about giving ourselves the permission to express, you know, in acting terms, in the circumstances that we're in, doing it your way. But I find that like the work that I'm doing really, people really respond who aren't actors, because it allows them to just get more honest with what's going on for them and being brave enough to share it with somebody else, whether that's like a barista at a Starbucks, like saying hello. I think also, you know what I mean? Like, I think we're living in a very interesting time now where people are having a real difficult time connecting because of, you know, dum, dum, dum. That is a pretty cover, but that is masking the evil technology called cell phones. You know, everybody is like this all the time. So it's further, you know, creating this disconnect that I think human beings, our DNA is to connect because we come from tribal consciousness, and yet it's also very scary to connect. So that's kind of the work that I'm doing with people. Did that answer your question? A lot of times I'll just go off on tangents. You'll have to like steer me back.
So you're saying it's kind of hard to connect with people, but what I want to know is there's tons of A-list actors. Actually, that's wrong. There are not that many.
Yeah.
So I say tons, but we're talking like hundreds, maybe a thousand, like people who are like, everyone's heard their name and everyone knows what they look like and they're like uber famous, right? And so you're working on coaching these people, but there's a skill set that comes from coaching, and there's a skill set that comes from high performers, and there's a skill set that comes from acting. And when you map those three things out, it seems like it's a vanishingly small number of people. And how the heck do you get to the point where you are the guy who's, you know, qualified to be the coach, where you have the right skill set, where you have the right mindset, and where you learn all the things you know? Because there aren't that many people who've focused on that niche. And I just find it fascinating because the actors I know are some of the highest demand people, and that the demands on their brain, like look good, stand this way,
right,
say these things,
yeah,
emote this emotion,
yeah,
remember
sorry,
your lines,
yeah,
and do it for 12 hours a day with bright light shining on you. Like it's a horrible thing,
yeah,
but they do it.
Yeah.
How do you get to be an expert at telling those guys how to do it better?
Well, I mean, I guess, you know, I was an actor myself, and I went up the ranks and went to school in London, went to grad school in London, worked, and then moved to New York and was part of the whole theater scene there, and then moved to LA. And so I feel like not only just do I have a language with actors because I am one.
You've been one.
Yeah. Yeah, but also I think, you know, from an early age, even I was telling some of this the other day, like even from an early age, like when I was 8 years old, I kind of knew I was a teacher because, okay, you know, like I come from a family, there's four of us siblings, and I always found that I was kind of the mediator in the family. Like when there were problems, people would come to me, or even in school, like from elementary school on, people would come to me and be like, there's a problem, and Tony would kind of fix it. Not that I fix people, but like I definitely felt like my skill set was able to like bridge disconnect. And, you know, so that's kind of like, that's kind of how I just kept evolving into teaching. And I feel like people who are teachers know that they're kind of teachers to their core. I mean, you're a teacher. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you know, and it's just like we find different modalities to express that gift. And so that's the whole thing. That's what I do. And, you know, there's a really great Sanskrit saying that the teacher and the taught together create the teaching. So for me, what's beautiful about what I'm doing is that I never feel like I'm here and the student is here,
yeah,
you know, applaud the teacher. It's really an organic, authentic process where together it's all about problem solving and facing our own fears, and then together having a breakthrough in awareness or consciousness or action to like get to a new level. So we're all in it together.
Yeah. If you're not learning from your students, you're doing it wrong.
Yeah. That's totally it.
That.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons I still coach people. Like, Dave, you're a CEO and you're doing all this stuff. And I'm like, yeah, I still coach for 1 or 2 hours a week with people because that's what keeps me learning. Okay, so you're doing it because you had a natural inborn
propensity.
Teaching,
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, yeah,
okay,
yeah, yeah.
And so because you're good at sharing this, you learn from top experts and you share with top experts, which is similar to the perspective I have on biohacking. But you also focus on something else that I think differentiates you and why I invited you on the show, which is that you're really all about risk-taking and the inner dialogue of fear, which I guess would come out in front of millions of people. So what's the deal about risk-taking? Like, why is that so important and how do you coach it?
Well, I mean, I think it's really simple. Like the things that I teach are, it's very kind of Bruce Lee inspired. You know, it's like this. It's like, well, I'm trying to rub my tummy. It's like, the core concepts are really understandable, but so it's simple in understanding, but the actual execution doesn't mean it's easy. Because again, I think we're like overcoming our life stuff, which is, I think we become very habituated in patterns of being that we feel safe and comfortable in. And anytime you want to get to a new level in your life, whether it's relationship or career or health, whatever it is, right? Like you have to push through and extraordinarily large amount of resistance. So for me, you know, the work is always about just getting people a little bit more conscious of where we're stuck. Because if you remain unconscious, you don't get unstuck, you know? Awareness is the key.
Okay, so now I'm picturing a good actor,
yeah,
mid-career looking to make it into the real big time. They come to you and they say, all right, I want to perform better. And you look at them and you say, you're stuck at X. What's the most likely X where they're stuck?
Ooh, well, I mean, that's a big, that's like a crazy good question, because I think there's like, I have discovered that all, like just being a teacher, the things that I most need to keep reminding me, ooh, that's like a power shake you're drinking there. Wow.
Yeah, I wish I could. We can cut camera angles, but this is basically a recipe from Bulletproof, the cookbook.
Of course.
It's like blended up vegetables and butter and brain octane.
That
so
looks
I'm
so
like starving,
good.
So I'm like eating during your interview.
No,
so
I love it. I wish I could like reach in and grab it. Okay, I lost.
Come to the coffee shop. We'll make it for you.
Okay, nice. Yeah. Because, yes, you have one in L.A.
Yeah, Santa Monica Bulletproof Coffee Shop. We have this exact kind of soup.
Okay, I'm there. That's totally awesome. So, Dave, sorry, where were we going with
note
that?
Note to self, wait for awesome answer, then drink crazy shake. I was asking if someone who's doing well but wants to really kick ass comes to you.
Yeah.
And then, like, okay, I need to come to a better place in my career.
Yeah.
And you look at them and you use your Jedi vision and you say, you're stuck. You're stuck at X. Like, look, what's the most common X?
Yeah.
Where do people get stuck?
Well, I think the beautiful thing about acting as a metaphor for life is that, like, let's say we're working on a scene or we're working on a project. Like, where the actor gets stuck in the project is always analogous to where they're stuck in life. So there are no, I don't believe that there is anything called an acting problem. So when I'm trying to solve a problem that's not, like, when I'm trying to solve a scene that's not working or it's not mm-hmm. truthful or a moment, it's not really about the scene. It's not about the subject. It's really about, or the subject matter rather, it's really about the person in those circumstances that is withholding. So they could be withholding. They don't want to get in touch with their rage. They're scared to be vulnerable. They don't want to be sexual, whatever it is. And then if you just like pull back the optics, they start to reveal that's where I'm stuck in life. And that's what scares me in life. And then if you pull back even further, you see how that's again, like, how that has resonance in their career or in their relationships. And none of these things are bad because they're all fluid and changing. But I discover that every actor I've worked with, basically where they're stuck in the work is where they're stuck in life. And wow. I think that that's why I think acting is the most tremendous metaphor for, you know, revealing back to humanity what it means to be human. Because they're really like, they're not only doing it in the work, but the process themselves is working through their own stuff in the work. So it's like meta, you know what I mean? I mean, it's crazy, it's deep.
It sounds really deep, I never knew that.
I get so deep on it.
if an actor is having a hard time, say like being authentic, say in like a sexual scene
or
something,
yeah.
Then you're like, okay, like you have sexual hangups and you need to work through those in your life so you can do it better on film?
Well, I wouldn't call them sexual hangups, you know what I mean? Like, because I think the array of sexualness is again a part of this is a really interesting jumping off point. It's like we have so much shame around sexuality. We have so much shame around pleasure and touch and intimacy and expressing those things, you know, in a safe, mutually expressive way. So and it's all based on the stories we've been told or what is and isn't okay based in religion. And so I think hangups I wouldn't use, although they are, I guess, but
I kind of use that on purpose to trigger you, to be honest.
Yeah, if I were a bad teacher.
you have discomfort around some aspect of sexuality or connectedness on a physical level with people.
Yeah.
So because you're uncomfortable subconsciously on camera, you look uncomfortable.
Yeah. And I even think that stuff is even not just unconscious. I think my philosophy about being alive is that at the core level, we are aware of almost everything. We are aware. We are infinitely connected to all, you know this, to all information. Now, the truth is we don't want to sometimes accept it, talk about it, name it, declare it, say it, be with it, live in it, open up to it. So we pretend that we don't know. You know, one of the things that I love saying to actors is like when we get stuck in something and I say, well, how was that? Or what's the challenge there? And they're like, I don't know. Then I'm like, okay, well, if a part of you did know, what would that part say? And Dave, it's so crazy. It takes them a minute. Like sometimes they'll still fight me and they're like, I don't know. And then it comes out and there's tears or like light bulbs or mic drop, you know. We do know. It's just very scary to name these things.
I did an exercise. This was a long time ago at a personal growth retreat. And they had you write a question to yourself with your right hand.
Okay.
And then allow your left hand to answer the question. And I'm like, this is such hocus pocus. Okay. It's not going to work. But of course, you're like there in a room with a bunch of people on yoga mats. So you're like, okay, I'll try it. And my left hand was writing stuff that I wasn't really planning on. And you're like, this is scary. It's like there's something else in there. And that's that awareness of other parts of you. And
wow, that is cool.
Yeah. And so I recognize them. We say, well, what would that answer be? You just sort of keep asking the question of someone. And magically, at a certain point, after they've heard the question six times, something pops into their head, and it's like the key that unlocks wherever they were stuck.
Yeah.
I mean, how does that tie to risk taking, though? Like, so someone's unwilling to take risks.
Well, you just, you know, again, like my light bulb went off about, you were talking about, okay, so writing right-handed is left brain, and left hand is right brain. So the fact that when you're writing left-handed, you're connected to the part that's not judgmental, not critical, not cerebral, not linear. Listen, there's a dexterity between them both. It's not like we're just right hemisphere or left hemisphere, right? So I'm not like dumbing it down, but it's not that, you know, black and white.
It's not unreasonable to dumb it down that way.
Okay, right. But I think that's the point, is that when we are in our right, more predominantly in our right hemisphere, we're more willing to take the risk, because the dialogue in our left brain isn't so loud, or it still may be loud, but you do it anyway. So I think the world of judgments is really, I think this thing about fear, I was thinking about our conversation today because, you know, my blog is called Giving Fear the Finger. And a lot of the work that I do is getting people to feel the fear and do it anyway, which that saying has been around forever. But I think that the challenge is we're not oriented towards self. And so where we keep from taking action or taking the risk is we're so externally referenced. So everything is about, how do I look? How will I be perceived? Is this okay? Am I safe to do this? What will they think? Am I going to be punished? So that minimizes our ability to take the risk. So if you start to do it as an active practice, like, you know, drinking bulletproof coffee and getting healthy and going to the gym and being more mindful, you know, that's the whole thing, is we're mindful of what we're eating nowadays, but we're still not mindful of what we're ingesting by what we say to ourselves.
Well, let's talk about giving fear the finger there a minute.
Yeah.
So I did masses of research. I've run an anti-aging research group for 10 years.
Okay.
And I've read all this stuff. And I'm like, you know what? The preponderance of evidence here is that cholesterol is probably good for you if it's not oxidized.
Right.
And it's certainly not bad for you if it's not oxidized. Therefore, eating lots of butter ought not to be a problem, but I couldn't really find much evidence of it. So I decided I would do this. And after like 3 months of doing like probably 8 tablespoons of butter a day, when I first started this, I was doing a lot to see like what would happen.
Okay.
And I kind of sat down, I'm like, you know what? Like, this is what everyone has told me my whole life will cause heart attacks, right? I'm like, but this is the science. This is what the research says. This is how I feel, which is freaking amazing, way better than I expected. Mm-hmm. So, like, and this is what the lab tests say. And it did take that giving fear the finger moment to say, you know, I'm just going to keep doing this. I'm going to keep getting my lab values, and I'm going to keep doing the research, rather than sort of saying, you know, this might be dangerous. And a lot of people, almost any time they're going to make a change in their life, even if with the right intent, there's that moment of reaching the edge where they say, well, I don't know what's going to happen. It might be dangerous. What do you say to someone who reaches that moment for whatever the change is to get them to give fear the finger, to get them to step over the edge?
Well, I think, you know, what does James Cameron say, which I love? He says, failure is an option, fear is not. Because you're still going to take, you know, who knows, maybe you would have, you know, continue to do your life research and then realize like, well, this is the amazing thing. You could have continued to move forward and then discovered that it didn't work out the way you thought it would. But in the doing of it, something else would have revealed itself because you're in the world of action. So that to me is really the whole point about being willing to take the risk, is that it's not that necessarily you're going to get A, B, and C, which are maybe the things you've written down or the things that you're envisioning, because it never looks the way it's going to look. But just by taking the leap, the beautiful thing about the moment is that other things reveal themselves that could not have had you not taken the leap. I mean, Goethe talks about that. Yeah, I mean, I'm going to paraphrase it. He said it much more poetically, but he's like, divine providence comes rushing in when you're willing to step into the unknown. We'll have to like fact check that, but that's really it.
It sounds way more eloquent than the German would have been, which would have been a lot more like, you know.
Do it. I mean, ultimately, you know, just do it, really. And then you worry about, you know, it's so funny because I was just in Iowa shooting something, and my DP on the way back, the cinematographer kept laughing. And I was like, why are you laughing? And he said, He said, throughout the whole process of filming, you just said, we'll figure it out. We'll figure it out. We'll figure it out. And you know what? If you're willing to, like, it's very scary to stay in being open to things that aren't quite working out how you think, but it does always, you always figure out. There's always solutions for things. You know, but if you don't take the risk, there is no, you don't have access to it. So that's the point.
That's core to the hacker mentality.
Yeah.
And I don't mean just biohacker, but even like computer hacker. You're like, well, we'll just kind of find a way around that obstacle.
Yeah.
Even if it's kind of like a half-assed way and, you know, we left the obstacle in place, but we're past it. So, you know, it got the job done. Versus we cleared an interstate through the obstacle with huge amounts of infrastructure and 20 years of planning and all that. It's like just get there and get there good enough to do what you want to do, which requires exactly what you're talking about. So now we have the situation where someone says, all right, I came up to this thing I'm afraid of. Mm-hmm. I recognized that I had an inner resistance to it, maybe one I didn't know about. I stepped past it. Right, so now they're going into the unknown, the way you just quoted Goethe. Okay, so you're in the unknown. What happens to the typical client or person you're coaching when they go into the unknown like that? What's the next step?
Well, again, I mean, I think that that's where the miracles occur. Because if you're, from an acting perspective, again, used as you know, an understanding of life itself, is every time you're open to the moment and what it wants to show you, there's a gift there. And, you know, I just recently blogged about stay open to life or you're fucked. Like, I mean, can I cuss on here?
Sure.
Or you're
yeah. We'll mark this one. We'll mark this one explicit. Yeah, we'll put masking tape over your mouth.
Oh, yeah, just believe it. Fine. But like, it's true. But I think sometimes people think, oh, being open just means being open to the, like the, you know, lama dama ding dong of it all. No, be, you know what I mean? The kumbaya.
That's a technical term, right?
Yeah, I'm so scientific. But the openness means also to the stuff that's scary and weird and funky that we don't want to feel. And that, you know, for me this year, just, I can only speak, I try to teach personally what I'm going through. And like, I've been going through like major, like seismic shifts of like, nobody, I've never found anybody who's really teaching phase of life stuff. So as you get older and you start moving into different phases, different things change, but you're
like the Ericksonian stages of adult development.
Oh.
Is that what you mean by phase of life? Or like,
I guess there is a book. I mean, I'm sure therapists and psychologists have talked about it, but maybe even more of like from a practical standpoint of, you know, I can't apply my awareness of who I was when I was 30 to where I am now. Also being okay that my views about things have changed since then, hopefully.
And that's how old are you anyway?
I am older. wait, no, this is going to go on the internet. No. I am a man in his 40s.
I can respect that. So you're older than 30.
There you go.
At least 10 years older than 30.
Yes. Right. So,
me too.
Yeah, there you go. Well, you look amazing. That's the perfect advertisement for Bulletproof Diet, right?
I'm actually
there.
74.
Amazing. You're as old as Methuselah.
I'm only 42.
So. Oh, okay, nice. So I guess that's the thing is like, but when you start to move into different phases, you have to be willing to let go some of the things that got you to where you are now if they're no longer working for you. And that is a very terrifying sort of proposition for someone. You know, I started thinking about Kim Davis, the county clerk of Kentucky.
Yeah.
Right? And I know this is so crazy, but because she's so in, you know, our awareness right now, I just thought, wow, at a deep core level, what this woman is really being confronted with is that behind her, like, prejudice is an inherent dogma that, you know, has served her. Well, not really, but let's just say for the sake of her own life, it's gotten her to where she is. And now
it made her feel safe.
That's exactly it. That's exactly it. And the foundation now has been ripped open. So who knows? It could be a huge watershed moment for her to realize, like, that sort of dogmatic, you know, like holding on to those beliefs that are now making her question if those beliefs are even accurate or, you know, loving based, let's say, could be a really powerful transformational moment for her. But that's also really scary because that means she has to sort of reshift the paradigm about everything that she's lived up until that point. That's terrifying. So I have a lot of compassion for her, even though her acts are, you know, I mean, it's, you know, disgusting. Like, she's, you know, prejudicial and homophobic and bigoted and But I still find like the core universal stuff that she's working through is really what we all work through.
Well, cognitive dissonance, when you realize, wow, the world is not the way I thought it was, it's scarier than hell. It's one of the scariest things you can have, because your whole reality, the way you've built it, the way you operate within it, you're like, uh-oh, like I'm operating on a set of rules that were false.
Yeah.
And when that sinks in, people like, they have mental breakdowns and things like that. Do the people you work with, do they ever have mental breakdowns? Like, holy crap, I've been acting the wrong way my whole life because I believed X and it was actually Y. I imagine it's got to be kind of gut-wrenching, some of the work that actors do.
It is. It's really intense. You know, I love that word cognitive dissonance, because I try to get actors to understand you can be in rage and be in compassion. You can be loving and be angry. We hold all things collectively together all at the same time. There's no hierarchy of feeling, you know? Like, I think the baseline of feeling is joy, and it's, but the expression of it is just energy manifested through a specific feeling. So for some people, again, that's very scary, because they're tapping into things that they have not allowed themselves to feel. And I really provoke people moving into those areas, because that's also a cathartic experience for those people experiencing it and for those people watching it. That's why I think everybody, all of your listeners, should take an acting class. You can go to any of my acting studios around the world. And it is so much more than being an actor. It's about figuring out who you are in connection with another person in the moment. And that's inherently risky, you know?
I second that notion. I've taken exactly one acting class at a California State University a while ago. And it was, I was taking it because it fit in my calendar. I'm like, oh, geez, this is like basket weaving 101.
Of course.
But it was actually, it was challenging. Yeah. It was really challenging. And it was emotionally not physically challenging, but it was more like emotionally challenging. You have to like really confront things that I never would have paid any attention to. So it is an exercise in self-awareness, and eventually biohacking. Like, if you want to change yourself based on changing the environment around you, if you don't know the state of the self, it's very hard to change it. Mm. So you have to have awareness to have control.
Well said. I concur.
So let's say that someone who's listening to this, who's not an actor, did decide to sign up and take an acting class. Like, what happens? Like, what do you do to them in there?
No, I mean, listen, it's all based on love and support and really honoring. You know, I think the big thing, Dave.
Oh, of course. Yeah. But just like, I'm assuming most people have never done it. They just have no idea. So like, what would you do in an acting class? Like just kind of walk me through, like what would you do in the first couple days or the first things? Like what would the outcome of a few weeks of acting training be? Because I really think most people have no clue.
You're right. I mean, but I think some people think like, and there are probably still classes that work this way. I'm really kind of like, I think we're on the cutting edge of like rethinking what it means to be creative. So that's very exciting. So a lot of acting training is still steeped in, you know, it's the same thing with you. What you're doing is like, you're an outlier. You're rethinking that which you were taught, which is what's exciting and inspiring about it. It's like, why do we keep believing? You know, Einstein talks about the world continues to expand and evolve. So to me, why isn't our consciousness about everything changing? So the maddeningness I feel sometimes about acting training is that, you know, it's like we're on an IBM computer, working on an IBM computer from 1980 when it's 2015. So, you know, our modalities have to change. And I think, like, it's not like you're going to come in and be, I'm going to be a tree. How does it feel to be a tree? You know what I mean? I love trees, and I think they're obviously important. But I'm really interested in what you would do is, in the very first day, we work with material, and you're forced to listen. And listening, you know, have you ever heard the TED Talk? From all of my work is based in listening, which is really about being, which is all meditation or consciousness-based. And Dave Assay, who was the founder of StoryCorps, another Dave, it's a common, very popular name.
Too many of us.
Yeah. You should look at his TED Talk, Dave. You would really, Dave, you would appreciate it. He's the founder of StoryCorps, which is, you know, when you go in to the actual booths and you can record someone, like a grandparent or a parent, some very personal questions that you've always wanted to ask them, so you have a living record of it. And it's become like the largest living record of vocal recordings in the Library of Congress.
Oh, this is cool. We'll link to this in the show notes, but I have heard of this now. Okay.
And he's not an actor. He wanted to be a journalist. That's how he started. And his first experience was interviewing people who live like in a halfway house or a homeless shelter. And he was so moved by the stories that people told. And his dad, I think what got him into it as well as his dad, he had never known, was a part of the gay liberation movement in the 1960s. I think he was part of the Stonewall Act, right? Or the Stonewall Riots. Okay. And he never knew that. First of all, he never knew his dad was gay. So I think his dad had come out to him. And then his dad told him these stories about being in the forefront of a revolutionary human movement, right? And so he, in that act of listening to his dad's story, I'm totally going to start crying. My God, it's so powerful. I cry a lot. Don't worry. Don't worry, listeners. Well, yeah, but I guess like it's not theatrics. I just like I'm so moved by this. So his listening to his dad's story really made him realize the power of listening. So he created StoryCorps, and he said it has been the listening has been the transformational experience in his entire life. And it's true. If you think about the entire universe is born out of listening, because it's all in reciprocity. Listening is receiving and giving. Listening is a state of being. So I just find that to me is so powerful and so simple. So you hear somebody say something to you and it evokes a reaction. And then are you brave enough to let your initial reaction be the response? That's scary because we have judgments about those responses.
When you look at how someone absorbs the world around them, right? You have listening, which is ears. You have seeing. Mm. You have like feeling. I think there's a emotional heart connection thing that's magnetic that you can measure with heart rate variability stuff.
Oh yeah, the vagus nerve. Heart rate variability.
There's something happening. And it's measurable, even though it's not widely acknowledged. But there's also like I think I said, touch. There's smell, and there's the tactile things that happen. You know, the hairs on the back of your neck.
Yeah.
All these things. All of those are a signal, and you're focusing on ears as listening. How important are the different senses for people who are working on hacking their fear, right? So you're saying first thing is listen, but what about all these other things? It feels to me like fear is almost more like a gut heart thing than an ear thing.
Well, okay, so interesting. I mean, I think you kind of touched on it. When I'm talking about listening to me is we listen from every place. We listen from our history, from our autobiography, from our fears. I mean, that's right there is the answer. When we hear somebody, if I ask somebody out on a date and they reject me, I'm hearing the words are neutral. Nothing happens to anybody on the planet. That just things happen. They're not happening to me. They're not happening to you. From a personal egoic identification, they are. It's like, oh my God, I was so terrible or so painful. I got rejected. But really, they're just happening. And then the way I process them subjectively for each of us is connected to my own story about rejection, abandonment, non-love, self-worth. See what I'm saying? So then that may trigger my fear and then ascribe meaning to this thing. I'm unlovable. I'm incapable of love. I'm ugly. Nobody's going to love me. I'm just using those as examples. But that's the kind of work that I'm passionate about is if we change the story, it's not that fear. I think fear is a very healthy, we just have to change our relationship to it and not hold us back. And if you understand that you can feel the fear and do it anyway, then you realize, I think that's the biggest misnomer is that people think they're supposed to not feel fear and then do something. But all the great innovators or creators talk about it's scary, but I'm going to take the leap. It's still scary, even though Meryl Streep talks about that. You know, she's done how many movies and won how many awards. And yet I know that she still feels the excitement, as Fritz Perls says, that fear is just, oh my God, is excitement without the breath. So we forget to breathe and we're overwhelmed. You know what I mean?
That's a great quote.
Yeah, it's a great quote. He was like the father of Jungian therapy, I believe, or really influential in that movement. And so that's my thing about fear is that it's a lot of it is associated to our story.
So you're a fear expert. I want to have you do a little coaching with me, and I want you to tell me if I'm weird. Well, I know I'm weird,
but okay.
Tell me if this is a viable approach and what you understand, and I'm totally happy, like I'm looking for criticism here. So many years ago, I was at a personal growth thing.
Okay.
And I grew up as an engineer, computer scientist, truth tables, that kind of thing. And I'm sitting there and the teacher there is doing stuff that makes me like kind of uncomfortable. Just it's a group thing. And
wait,
like,
what, kind of things? What kind of things?
She was touching. No, she, no. It was like a group thing, like, you know, get in touch with your feelings.
Kind of thing. Okay, yeah.
And I'm like, this is lame, like whatever, like I want to go somewhere else, this isn't doing it for me. And I was pretty closed off. But I was physically uncomfortable in the room. And she said, well, you have to be feeling something. I said, yeah, I'm feeling pretty pissed off. Like, you know, I'm not happy with where I am in my life right now, you know, not happy with relationships, but like I'm pretty pissed. She goes, there's other feelings in there. And I'm like, no, there's not. And so like over the course of the day, she sits with me and she goes, all right, is there a feeling like in your stomach? I'm like, yeah, my stomach feels a little weird. She goes, yeah, there's a name for that. And I go, really? She goes, yeah, it's called fear. Mm-hmm. And I was like, really? That's what that is? Like, I had no idea. And I realized I had this cognitive loop that was like, there's no rational reason to be afraid of something. Mm. Therefore, I'm not afraid. Therefore, that feeling is not fear. So essentially, I had taught myself to just ignore that signal coming in from my environment, which wasn't serving me very well, as you can well imagine. So I started out from there. I said, all right, great. I need to learn to recognize the signal. And then I realized, well, this is annoying because I actually have fear all the time about different things and it pisses me off. So I've spent now 10 weeks of my life doing neurofeedback where it's essentially a lie detector and you can go into altered states and you basically tell your nervous system that the things that cause you to be afraid, like things that programmed you to be fearful, I just tell my nervous system that they didn't really happen that way. And then I stop having the fear response. So someone interviewed me yesterday and they said, tell me about your greatest fear. And I was like, holy crap, I can't find one. And if I did find one, I would like stick electrodes on my head and go in there and I'd zap that thing because I don't want fears like running my life. It's bad.
Right.
Now, does that make me like a robot monster? Or is that a viable approach to dealing with fear? Because it was the only thing I could figure out that worked. But I walk around like in a pretty happy state most of the time.
No, I mean, I've not ever heard of that biofeedback. What's it called again?
It's called neurofeedback.
So neurofeedback.
I do it with some clients. It's called 40 Years of Zen. And we train your brain to be in the same state as someone who's done 40 years of daily Zen practice. But what's really going on is a lie detector. And if you tell yourself, I'm not feeling that, the lie detector's like, yeah, you are, buddy. Are. Uh-huh. And so you try to hide from your demons. You can't hide from them when the computer is like, liar, liar, liar. And eventually then you come to face with whatever it is that's really holding you back. And then when that happens, you're like, okay, you go into another state and basically re-script the story. Kind of like you can do reparenting. Mm-hmm. Like there's various things where I'm guessing you might do this or might refer people out to do this. Things like EMDR, where someone's had a trauma, the trauma results in them freezing up or acting in a certain way when they're exposed to some input, whether it's on stage or not. So I'm like, I don't like it when my nervous system does that to me. Mm. So anytime I can identify a pattern like that, I'll go in and I'll erase the situation that happened so that I'm cognitively aware that, you know, someone was mean to me in second grade, but that I don't automatically like clench up when that situation reappears in my life now.
Well, I think the simpler solution is just tequila. I mean, that would always...
See, I knew you'd have something you could be to say here.
I mean,
am I doing a bad thing? People might say it's bad.
No, I think it's interesting because if sort of that technology or that awareness is available to us, you try it. Like, I think the thing to me, I used to be scared of everything and I still get scared about a lot of stuff. But I think to me, the thing that I keep coming back to are two things. One is, I don't think there are any absolute states, because if we keep thinking that there's an absolute place to be, you're always going to fail. You're never going to get there because you're going to be comparing yourself to an illusion and then you're going to stop. So when I mean like absolute states, like I remember there's a Rinpoche who, when he was ready to, he was like 80 years old and he was in the hospital and he was on his way to the next, wherever he's going, he's going to die. And the devotees or one of his pupils came to him and asked him like, how are you doing? Or how are you feeling? And he's like, I'm scared. And it was like, to me, it was so interesting because we think that people who've been meditating for 40 years are exalted beings or do have a way of being in the world that seems to be there in it, but beyond it, we're still in a human body. And I think if we change our relationship to it, again, just awareness helps us to be okay with it. My whole thing is that most people act out of automated responses and they're not awake. So they're asleep behind their own wheel of life. And so just the simplest act of just doing this, I'm just taking a breath, can help us just, the breath is life itself. You know what I mean? But we don't use it. We breathe like this, or we don't breathe. And so for me, my work in the last few years has also just changed to, once I get people to just breathe more consciously, they drop in and then the fear turns into something else. So I don't know if I answered your question. I think it's a bit of everything. You try everything.
Another way to phrase it might be, I'm just thinking about it, because I wasn't planning on asking that, but you're like, I get to ask,
yeah, no, it's
ask
cool.
people questions about stuff I'm curious about. So this is so fun. One school of thought would say, the things that wrote those automated scripts, those automated reactions you have, that those have value and you should leave the programming in place and just be aware of the programming. Uh-huh. And then, oh, look, there's a wave of fear, a wave of anger, but I'm so zen, for lack of a better word, that I'm just going to acknowledge the emotion. I'm going to let it wash through me. It'll not impact mm-hmm. me. And then I'm going to go on with my day mm-hmm. and do what I wanted to do. And that is a skill and one that I've cultivated. But I'm also lazy. Like, wouldn't it be easier?
Yes.
If like it just didn't happen because it wasn't serving me,
Dave,
like I just edit the code, right?
Yeah. Well, listen, I think the amazing thing about technology nowadays, maybe there are ways of getting in there faster. But my whole thing about life is you can't skip steps. You just can't. You just cannot skip steps. I've tried to run away from things that, you know, I come back and like, it's still here at 40 something. You know what I mean? At 45, yeah. You know what I mean? So it's like, you just got to deal with it. But I mean, I think, I think whatever helps somebody feel like they're moving forward is a beautiful thing. That's the most important.
Got it. So you don't have a strong opinion about whether leaving the fear triggers intact and accepting it versus editing them out.
No.
There's no science behind
that.
Yeah. No science behind like which one's better than the other.
Yeah.
I'm just looking at it from like what worked. Speaking of what worked, I mean, a lot of people talk about getting out of their own way or shutting up the voices in their head.
Mm-hmm.
What's your advice as a coach when people say, I want to stop getting in my own way, or I don't want those voices in my head, the ones that are trying to tell you the things you just talked about?
Yeah.
What do you say to that?
Well, for a lot of people, listen, I just think everybody, the science is in about meditation. And, you know, my dear friend, Emily Fletcher, who you had on your show, who's, she connected us. And I've been meditating for 15 years and more than that now. And like my whole life has changed because of it. And I used to be, like I said, so freaked out about everything and so neurotic. And that doesn't mean that I still don't have those moments, but I do feel like I've transformed a lot because of meditation, where at some point you have to like come to terms with the things that I tell myself are not the truth. I've taken them. They're just, it's my belief system because I've been telling it to myself over and over again, but there's no validity that makes that true. Everything is a judgment and it's all subjective. So my other motto is just like, just what makes you feel the best? Does it make you feel good to like be terrorized by your thoughts? You know what I mean? Like, does that feel good? And you know, my short answer is, for a lot of us, it does, because we're so attached to our pain and our stories about victimization and rationalization and like staying stuck. Because again, to give that up means you have to step into something where you're going to be accountable at a new level. It's really about up leveling and like, I'm going to take the risk even if I fail. And that makes you deal with your shit, you know?
Well, there are some famous examples of actors and actresses who are, you know, what we'll call them, egotistical, who are, you know, they're not nice to the
yeah.
people around them. They're, you know, they're kind of angry of abusive types. And then there's other ones who are just like truly kind. I'm thinking about Brandon Routh, who I'm
interviewed.
Friends with.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
I've interviewed him. And,
yeah.
Like we've gotten to be friends, but we made Bulletproof Coffee on the set for him at Legends of Tomorrow. And, but he knows the name of every single person there, mm. including like, you know, the second the second down the chain at the Kraft Food Services.
Right.
And he's like one of the nicest guys I've ever met. Like there's not a bone of ego in him in a bad way. And so that like, there's two very different camps that you could describe within actors. How do you treat people differently when they come to you for coaching? If they're the kind, humble guy versus I'm full of ego, but I need my ego to be part of my character kind of thing. What's your advice for that? Because I think that translates to everyone who's here. Like people, you know, either you know which side of that spectrum you fall on.
Yeah.
Generally, most people are somewhere in the middle.
Well, I would never think that ego is a part of the character we're playing, because ego, you know, that would become redundant because we're all egoic beings, right?
Fair point.
Yeah,
right.
That's a good point. So my thing is I just try to really see through people and realize like, okay, that's not what's going on is they're really insecure or they're scared. Talk about fear. They're scared about something. So they're having to prove something else until they get a sense that they feel safe to be vulnerable or they're protected or you're on their side. You know, I get it. Like from an acting perspective, it's very scary because you're just jumping. Like I said, I just shot something with one of my students, no less, who's extraordinary. And the scene is so intense. And she kept saying, now, Tony, I trust you. But she led from that, which basically means she doesn't trust me. We were laughing about that. But then ultimately she did. She surrendered to what I was asking her. And then later on, she had an epiphany and she's like, it wasn't that I don't trust you because she's been working with me for a number of years. She said, I've never really allowed myself. She came in and replaced someone at the last minute. So she only had like, she had no time to prepare. I flew her. I said, are you available? Can you do this? She flew to Iowa in like a day. Wow. And so she had no time for anything. And she said, I've never jumped into something without being prepared. And she said it was inherently scary for her. So of course, what's the first thing that's going to come up is like, you know, she's going to be like that. Because to move into this domain of like letting go, surrendering, trusting, letting the moment happen is alien for a lot of people. But then of course it creates the most exciting work. She was amazing, like so powerful. So that's my thing, is I just try to recognize, I kind of feel like I'm a detective with actors. I just, you know, you recognize it and you try to move through it. And
okay, that makes sense.
You know? And listen, does anybody really nowadays, 2015, I don't think anybody can get away with not being nice. First of all, you should just be nice. Just be nice. Like just.
It makes the world a better place.
My gosh, what's the deal? Like, you know, or if you get triggered, because I'm not here, you don't have to shame yourself when you get triggered and you have a reaction, because that happens too. But then just be like, oh, I'm sorry. That's also, oh my God.
How much does bullying in childhood affect the way people like get these fears? I run across.
It's so weird that you're saying that.
I run across a group of people I've coached and people you come across online where you're like that guy's been seriously bullied and he's still acting that way. Mm. What's your take on that from actors or anyone else?
Well, you know, it's weird because when I was thinking about myself, all the fears that I had to overcome, like I was bullied a lot. And
yeah, so was I.
I was going to ask you that. Yeah. And you know, Dave, oh my God, I'm totally going to start crying. See, it's still there. I carry it with me. Like I've healed through it. I've done, you know, like it's been an amazing part of the journey. But one of the things, ironically, that was so scary for me is that I would always have, in high school, I would always have panic attacks about being in front of people. Wow. Because I thought people would call me a fag or, you know, out me in some way. I didn't even know what I was at that time. You know what I mean? Like I didn't even know what gay was. I just was like, I knew I was different, but it was scary. And I lived in the Midwest. And so for me, but it was terrorizing. Like we would have these assemblies. And I was a good student and I was an athlete. I was very successful. So like I would often be called on, but I would literally like to the point of vomiting because I was so scared of that.
Wow.
And isn't it ironic that here I am, I had an epiphany the other day, but like a lot of the things that I do, I never plan anything. When I give speeches, and I give speeches in front of like thousands, I've done it in front of thousands of people, like I don't plan anything. And I realize like, oh my God, my greatest fear is to be in front of people. And like to do stand up. And I have actors who do stand up and I'm like, I can't even go see their stand up work because it just scares me so much. Like, what if it's like
womp, womp. Fear of clowns, fear of stand up.
Yes, they're right there. It was because like, if it's not funny, it's like so uncomfortable. And yet I realized like I had an epiphany. I was like, oh my God, what I do is stand up because I just, where was I lecturing the other day? It was in Vancouver. I was like teaching at our school there.
Right next door.
Yeah. And I lectured, it was just only like 100 people, but I don't plan anything. And sometimes I'll say things that I think are funny and people laugh. And sometimes I'll say something and it's like, wah, 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 wah. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm like doing the thing that scares me the most. So without even realizing I was doing it. So I went off on that boring story, but my point was, I think the beautiful thing about our experiences is if look at how that experience of being bullied has also creatively become a part of something that I work with that's made me who I am. So one could argue that all experiences are valid and needed and a part of your story, a part of your autobiography, you know?
It's true.
It's powerful.
It is. So bullying.
But bullying is bad.
Yeah, it's bad, but you know, that whole thing, what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Ooh. It doesn't mean that it was the optimal thing to have happened. And I run into clients, you know, who were bullied, and they'll shy away from a business situation because it's triggering the automated response system that you get in, you know, fifth grade when someone smacks you in the face. Like, you suddenly get this I might die thing. So now someone does something in business that feels like a shot to the face, and you go into that weird state that doesn't make any sense whatsoever. And I'm just wondering, like, does that happen on the set where, you know, I would imagine that you would, if you're reenacting a bullying scene and you're on the set and all of a sudden that gets triggered, does it trigger the real emotion that then causes people to have to do that awareness? Or is that not really something that happens to actors?
I mean, this isn't exactly the same. It wasn't a bullying experience, but I had a woman in class last week who was doing a scene where her lover has basically caught her cheating and basically is kicking her out of the house. And it's it's intense. And it's intense. Like, my palms were sweating watching it. That's how real it is. And then afterward, and the woman in the scene, who's really incredible, she would just sometimes like float out and disconnect. And then she'd come back to the moment and then float out. And afterwards I asked her, I was like, are you aware that you're doing that? And in the moment, Dave, it's so crazy because we record like my masterclasses. You just see her go like this, and then that, and then she starts to cry. And she said basically like her realization was, when she was a kid, she used to be left at home when her mom would go to work or whatever with babysitters. Yeah. And the babysitters would often be abusive, and like, so it, her own connection of being thrown out was kind of like things that happened to her actually in her past. So I think for all human beings, we all carry trauma in our bodies. Mm-hmm. And I think, again, what's great about therapy, what's great about being in a movement orientated, like just living in your body in a physiological way, but also an emotional way, helps us to move through where those things are stuck. You have to free those energies up. You have to have awareness about it. So I think, you know, awareness is the key. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy, but you have to start moving through it, you know?
You wrote about something called the impossible 7-day challenge of complaining for
yes.
a week.
Yeah.
What's the deal with complaining, and why is it so hard to stop complaining?
I need to get back on that, Dave. Thanks for that reminder. It's so powerful because you realize, like, complaining is just a placeholder for you don't want to take responsibility. You don't want to get accountable. You don't, like, complaining to me is a passive aggressive form of fear. It's really intense. You start to see like, oh, what's underneath that is you don't, you know, fill in the blank. You don't want to A, B, or C. So it's easier to just complain. It's easier to blame. I need to do that right now. I was going to say right when we hang up, but like right now, because whenever I complain, it's really my resistance to something, you know? I really encourage your listeners to try it. And it's hard. And the rule we had at our studios was, if you complain, you have to go back to day one. So if you made it to day six and you're like, oh, I almost made it. But then you're like, why is my Starbucks cold? You got to go back to day one. You know what I mean? Oh, I shouldn't be like promoting Starbucks. I should be promoting Bulletproof Coffee.
But they promote Starbucks. Well, Starbucks brought like espresso to the world.
Well, that's so true. They did.
They did a good thing. And maybe Bulletproof can do something different.
Well, I was going to say Bulletproof would not incorrectly make your coffee.
I would hope not.
So you wouldn't have to complain about that.
If so, I'd whine.
So yeah, you should try it. It's really intense. And it actually really starts to give you insight about, why am I complaining when just to be alive is the most, you know, listen, I think Westerners also have a real difficult time getting their heads around 70% of the rest of the world's population is like living on like $3 a day. We got to get our shit together, people. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, I'm not trivializing what we all are going through. We all have hopes and dreams and want to move forward in our lives and be successful and happy. And that's all important. But I think we get so consumed with things that in a year from now are just not even a part of our experience. But again, that's just, it's mindfulness. It's mindfulness, you know?
It is. I'm going to hit one other big question before we reach the end of the interview.
Okay. Oh, it's so much fun.
I know. I'm having a great time.
Yeah. Are you? Okay, good.
Oh, absolutely. You also write about 5 rules for a better life.
Ooh, and to remind
like
me,
you,
I
don't
change every day.
All of the
no,
posts, you write.
Tell me.
So you talk about staying open when you want to hide, shut down, or retreat.
Yeah.
Okay. Why?
Well, like, I mean, we've touched on it because the core of our existence is vulnerability, and staying open means you will be thrust into vulnerability, which is ultimately the most empowering place to be, which is, see, it's so counterintuitive. A lot of time when actors come to me, or people, period, they equate vulnerability with weakness. Our empowered state of being is the most powerful point of being. And so vulnerability means you're willing to show and be with someone else in a way that gives them the permission to be. So if I allow myself to cry, which is doesn't feel like, you know, even though I cry a lot, it's still not easy. But because I'm allowing myself to have that experience, I'm giving somebody else the permission and the understanding that it's also okay for them to feel. And if you're not open to it, I mean, then I think we walk around like robotic zombies. So I think being open is the key to life.
You also talk about why you should embarrass yourself.
Well, it's risk-taking.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Just for risk.
You have to be, you can't be risk averse. Life inherently is embarrassing. It's just weird. I mean, it's embarrassing. I fall down all the time, or I say inappropriate things, or, you know, yesterday I was at the gym and I thought this guy was looking at me and I was like, hey, and then he was like looking at himself in the mirror. I mean, he wasn't looking at me. You know what I mean? So it's like you have to. You know what? If you're not embarrassing yourself, then you're not putting yourself out there. But people like live in this too cool for school zone, and they think it's like, you know, let someone come to me. Bullshit. You don't have time for that.
Okay. Then you talk about something interesting in this blog post.
Okay.
That you say, take the leap and the net will appear.
Yes.
And this is something that, okay, you're an entrepreneur, you're running a company worth $5 million. You say that to someone like that.
Man, I know.
Like that triggers all the vulnerability things, because if your company goes down, you feel like you're dying. That's the way most entrepreneurs feel. So what is this net appearing thing you talked about?
Well, I guess the thing to get your head around is that it does not. Okay. What's the saying that John Lennon said? It all works out in the end. And if it's not working out, you're just not at the end. So I think he said that, right? Have you heard that quote? You're looking at me skeptically right now.
I make up a lot of quotes myself. I'm not kidding.
No. That's a John Lennon quote. That is.
I believe. Yeah. I don't know if it is or not.
And my thing about taking the leap, it doesn't mean that in the short term, the thing that you were going for is going to manifest, is going to be there. But again, the science is, to me, the science is in. Just from like, you know, I realize like, you know, there's a lot of researchers that write books about, you know, the human experience, and they always use the word, my data shows, my research shows. So they're academics who have control groups, and they're all great. Like, I can name many of them. They're all doing TED Talks, right? And they've really helped start a new conversation about stuff. But I've realized, like, I don't need a control group. My control group has been the experience of working with thousands of human beings in this modality of acting, which isn't acting at all. It's just allowing ourselves to be human. And what I've discovered is oh, I just lost my train of thought. Oh, taking the leap is, even though the thing that we may be going for, the promotion, the job, the new agent, whatever it is, the girlfriend, that thing is not the final result. Something else that is correlated to, perhaps down the line, or indirectly related to, presents itself. Whereas if you don't take the leap, you're like this. You're in a closed system. You took the leap to create your brand. This is the thing that we forget, is all the successes that we've had in life are, listen, my whole thing, and I might be one of those 5 points, is that we are littered, our lives are littered with failure, but we don't really remember the failures, because the failures are also the jumping off point for success. And we're so focused on success, success, success. And then you don't realize, like, well, in the seed of, in failure is that seed of success. So it's numbers. So if you don't take the leap, then you've minimized anything from happening.
If you don't start on the path, you'll never get there.
That's totally it. Yeah. Yeah. I guess you said it much simpler than I did. Sorry. I took 4 minutes and you said it in 2 seconds. Thank you,
that
Dave.
That wasn't John Lennon. That was Sigmund Freud's second cousin.
Okay.
Simon Freud.
Oh, my God.
Now, the final question, okay. And I'm really curious what your answer is going to be here. It's one I've asked every guest on the show for 250 something episodes.
God.
So no pressure here. given all the stuff you know, not just as an actor coach, but just your path through life. If someone came to you tomorrow and said, I want to kick more ass at life, like I want to be better at everything, what are the three most important things I need to know? What would you tell them?
Okay. Love, gratitude, and service. I mean,
awesome.
That's it. Look, totally going to start crying again. I mean, that is it.
Oh, that's very, very pithy. In fact, that would be the shortest answer and the fastest answer ever.
See, I was trying to match you and you're like,
but also, no, that's one that's very much in alignment with what I would have said. So I think you nailed that one. Executing on those things definitely takes some learning.
Oh,
some
for skill, sure.
But yeah, those are the things.
Yeah. So
thank you, Anthony, for
and
being on the show.
And scene.
Well, almost. First, you got to tell people where they can find out about you and your work and things like
that.
So
cool.
If people actually want to take you up on that acting class thing, where can they do that?
Or, you know, just follow my blog or whatever. Well, you can go to www.anthonymeindl.com. And, or I also have these popular videos on YouTube that are just about creating. It's not about acting really. It's about creating, being more creative. And that's youtube.com/AnthonyMeindl. There's that.
There's also something else I was hoping you'd plug, but you were so selfless you didn't.
No.
You have a new book.
Oh, I will plug
it. Suit for grown-ups. So I'll plug it for you because people know about that.
Audio visual. That one.
26 ways to worry and be happy and get over yourself. It's a good book. People who read this, and the other one, at left brain, turn right. So if you're interested in creativity and fear and hacking the voices in your head, you've written about it. You've trained world-class actors about it. It's like you're an authority in the field. And you've written some good stuff. So people who want to learn more, they can check out your videos, they can check out your blog, and they can buy one of your books. And we'll put links to all that stuff in the show notes as well.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you for your time on the show.
Dave, thank you. It was really amazing. You're doing great work. I love your coffee. That's not just, you know, a random plug. It's true. And I love what you're doing. I appreciate people who are innovators and out there, like, starting new conversations. So thanks for letting me be a part of it. And thanks to all of your fans that are listening. It's really a cool forum.
Likewise. Have an awesome day.
Thanks, Dave. Yeah. Let's stay in touch. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay. Coolio.